As Ayush mentioned earlier, that now Lotus can also sync mainnet, Filecoin mainnet, with FVM using built-in actor, which is super exciting. We are the node is now launching in Lotus V1.15.1, like RC. We're getting it tested with some of our TSEs. So that's that. Yes, Venus and Forest seems to be beating us. You know, they are also on mainnet there, very exciting. First step towards FVM.
Slingshot.
Hey everybody, we launched a new program within the Slingshot umbrella yesterday, actually, called Slingshot Evergreen. For those of you that have been following, Slingshot has been on a nice long journey or since mainnet of onboarding loads and loads of data to the network. I think we're just at about 35 terabytes now in terms of data onboarded of about 61, I believe, public and open data sets across the board. But of course, 15 months also means some of the initial deals have started to expire, and we want to ensure that data isn't lost so that we can reliably host mirrors of those data sets on the network into the long term. So Evergreen is effectively like a mechanism or a long-term program that watches for data that is in deals that are expiring in the next 2 months and puts them up for effectively like renewal. And so storage providers can sign up, get vetted, and then identify specific PCIDs that they're interested in storing in verified deals for the next year and a half. And we'll automate like deal proposals for them. You should check out the program details, our super swanky website. And like, really want to thank the team for a lot of hard work over the last week to get this out the door. Nailed the timer.
Good stuff. All right. NFT Storage Gateway.
Hello. It's Alan's lucky day. Get to see my face again. We launched an NFT Storage Gateway. It's a little bit misleading if you come from the world of IPFS gateways, where it's actually a gateway racer. Folks send HTTP requests to the NFT storage gateway, nftstorage.link, and then we race multiple public gateways by sending requests to them, and then the first one to get back to us with the data, we serve it up to the client. It does come with very aggressive CDN caching, cloud workers. It's built on cloud workers running on the edge, so we do get to take advantage of a lot of, you know, the awesome caching infrastructure out there. We actually have had a 70% plus cache hit rate so far for content requested on the NFT storage gateway, just really specializing and doubling down on NFT storage or NFT CIDs. And there's been about 30 million requests in the last 7 days. So a lot of folks have already started using it. There are upgrades coming soon, a paid permacache super hot gateway. Contrary to what you might believe, I did not make this. It was Vasco with the help of NetOps, and really appreciate the hard work there. Another thing we shipped, I mentioned earlier, UCAN delegated uploads. Hugo was the real driver here. There's a problem in NFT storage previously where we would issue API tokens, but our users couldn't put those API tokens in their end users' browsers. And as a result, would have to put up a proxy server to kind of be an intermediate touch point to upload data to NFT storage. But now you can do it without this proxy server because of UCANs. There are JWTs where you can have a chain of signatures signed with folks' DIDs to grant subsets of permissions to subsequent UCAN tokens. So a user can get a UCAN token authorizing them to upload data on the marketplace's behalf directly to NFT.Storage. And you know, it's coming in Web3 storage soon. It's going to be super valuable there as well. We're spinning out a general UCAN microservice to kind of combine all this into one thing, as well as use it in our new uploads flow I was talking about earlier. So super excited about that. Please test it out if this sounds interesting to you. And finally, there was a big Web3 storage redesign, and it is real drippy. It's nice looking. Please check it out. Agency Undone did this for us. Not a whole bunch to say other than it looks completely different and super sleek.
I'm a boost here.
Hello, boost. Yeah, it's coming. It's so close. So we're kicking off testing with SPs next week, which is very, very exciting. And we're on track for a full release in April. We're wrapping up right now updates to Estuary and Fill Client, so that when Boost launches, they'll be able to take advantage of it right away. We're also working with Textile to get support into Auctioneer and BidBot. So all those offline deals will no longer need to be offline. It's going to be great. And what is Boost? Well, here's a couple feature highlights. So Boost is the new version of Markets for Lotus It's fully backwards compatible with the current version of Lotus. It's also standalone. So Lotus can release on its own and Boost can release on its own. It's really, really great. They only depend on the Lotus API, which is awesome. We're also launching with support for storage over HTTP. So all those car files you have on S3, guess what? You can just make deals with them directly. We're also launching with a lightweight CLI client for data preparation and storage. So if you ever thought like deal making on Lotus or deal making on Filecoin was too hard, it's going to get easier so soon. We're also launching with a web UI for storage providers. And you can check out a bunch of the in-progress docs at boost.filecoin.io. Thanks.
All right. So just a quick update from the FVM Early Builders Program. This has been great work from Ali and Dragon happening here. We had over 100 applications, out of which we accepted 25 teams and individuals. And last week, we had an informal meet and greet call. 45 folks from many groups joined, including people from Valis, Immense DAO, Polyphene, Phil Swan, all of those groups that are listed on the left. And we basically went around the room and introduced ourselves. And it felt like there was great energy, enthusiasm, and it felt like the start of something big. Lots of cool builders all around the world. And each team spoke about what they're aspiring to build on top of the FVM. And some of the great ideas there were things around reputation systems, cross-chain bridges and L2s, new SDKs, indexing services, a bunch of things there, pretty cool stuff. And last but not least, Ali and Dragon also worked on spinning up a Notion website for the program. So there's a link in the slide. Go into the slide and check it out. And Ali is also putting together a public directory of all the teams that are participating and what everybody's working on so that you can spy on the progress there and like stay updated with everything that's happening inside the program. So make sure to check it out once it's out.
All right. DRAN is in space. We have been collaborating with CryptoSat for a while, since last year, September last year, and finally the experiment went live and it was successful. They actually ran an instance of DRAN between a node in the ISS and on the ground station, and they intend to roll this out to multiple satellites in the future. And essentially, this is going to become a new frontier for more trusted, tamper-proof computation, so to speak. So DRAN is one of the first early set of protocols that are going to be onboarded into space, and we are looking forward to working with them further. So stay tuned. We actually grew our ecosystem collaborations as well. So a couple of weeks ago, we actually had ETH Global's BuildQuest Summit on Web3 gaming, and we gave a talk on DRAN, and a lot of folks excited, got a few responses on Twitter as well. So, you know, kind of building up on the ecosystem collaborations going forwards. We also grew the League of Entropy, the collection of the partners that actually operate the DRAN network as a decentralized network. StoreSwift joined us as a 15th member, and we have a couple of new members lined up as well, including CryptoSat as well. And of course, we completed the development of new DRAN features, which is quite groundbreaking in a sense. One of the first few randomness beacons, which will be unchained, and will actually also be enable us to run multiple variable frequency networks, which means we can run the 30-second network. And in addition to that, we can also run lower frequency networks as needed for supporting additional use cases. So testing is going to commence next month, and we intend to file a Filecoin FIP and engage with the Filecoin team to understand how best they can actually make use of the new features that we are actually launching. Timeline is not a concern. It's more about making sure that we find the right integration with Filecoin in the future that can make use of the new features. And of course, we are kicking off a number of LOE, League of Entropy focused projects that are going to make life easier for this 15 odd independent organizations to kind of operate DRAN. Thanks to Yanis, Nicola, Yolan, Mario, Will, Hector. I think it's been an amazing push that we have been giving here, and looking forward to taking DRAN to the next level and growing the LOE as well. Thank you.
Hello. It's Yanis here. I'm coming to report after a great meeting that we had in Berlin with ResNet Lab and our collaborators. We gathered everyone for the second time physically in Berlin, and we had great updates from all the teams. We had lots of what they're doing. There was lots of enthusiasm, lots of breakout sessions, and lots of results. There was many libp2p and IPFS students that joined, so thank you for joining. It's a great way to start working closer together. The primary topic was on network measurements and benchmarking and protocol optimization. I gave a demo in the EngRes demo day on the 10th of March, so watch that recording. We've produced a 14-page report with all of the latest results, and there are links here to find out the outcomes of the meeting, which, to go in a little bit more detail, are a list of items that we want to dive deep into. This includes the flare nut hole punching that Max and others mentioned previously. We want to see better, you know, how the effectiveness and the performance of protocols like BitSwap. We want to identify if there are peers with rotating peer IDs in the network, which might be screwing up some of the content routing processes, unresponsive DHT server nodes, the reliability and effectiveness of Hydra nodes, and so on, and eventually build what we have a vision for, the IPFS Network Observatory, where one will is going to be able to look into the network from multiple different perspectives and be able to identify, you know, problems and where there is space for improvement. This is the GitHub repository that we're going to be using. There are already several RFMs, requests for measurements. So if you're interested, just follow that repository. And out of that, it became clear that we need to have a dedicated team that is going to be working on protocol benchmarking and optimization, and we call that the Probe Lab. It's still in formation, and it's going to live in within production engineering, which is a new group that is going to be announced very soon, so stay tuned. There is going to be lots of collaborations with IPFS and libp2p students. Again, as was said previously, we have a Notion page where we explain and we have pointers about everything we're working on. The first order targets is the nut hole punching, success rate measurement, optimistic provide, and several network measurements for the IPFS observatory. The main motto here is that, you know, we're not measuring networks just for the sake. This is not an end, but what we want to do out of this is identify bottlenecks, find bugs, quantify the available space for improvement, and eventually have protocol optimizations. We are going to have grants for that, milestone grants. So get ready, spread the word, and follow us to see, you know, interesting things. We have already some results on nut hole punching. You can see a snapshot of a Grafana dashboard down on the right-hand side, but there is much more to come. Thank you.